Living in a city has several benefits. We often say, it's great to have everything you need nearby. Go grocery shopping, enjoy a nice dinner, or spend an afternoon in the park.
Not everybody, though, has equal access to such amenities and services. And the reason for this can be traced back to how we design and plan our living and social environments. What do we take into account when we decide where to locate people, services, and infrastructure? Whose needs do we consider, or even favor, and whose do we leave out? Does having something nearby mean the same to a young child, an older person, or a mobility-impaired person? The main challenge we designers and urban planners have to address is, how can design help us create the conditions for more livable neighborhoods and communities that promote well-being and healthier lifestyles?
Take parks, for instance. We know they can be beneficial for our physical and mental health in many different ways. There's plenty of evidence out there already.
A park here in Rotterdam was once designed and built to provide fresh air, shade, and places to meet and relax. It's large and centrally located in the city, next to the River Maas.
Elderly people and surrounding neighborhoods could benefit from it, and children and families in the park.
These kinds of encounters work well to combat loneliness and mitigate age segregation, as research has shown. Researchers, urban planners, and municipalities currently look almost exclusively at the distance between people's residences and at the park to determine if enough Rotterdammers have access to this green space. But who is actually using it, and who do they encounter when they do? This is where we at TU Delft believe location intelligence comes in. What is the daily activity behavior of different people in a city? What are their habits, daily rhythms, and routine behavior outside of their homes? To get a better grasp of this, we collect publicly available location data from online maps, population repositories, traces from social media, and mobile phone usage, among many other sources. By analyzing this data, we can see, for instance, that the wide car roads surrounding a park act as barriers for elderly people to access it. The river itself is only crossable through a tunnel with limited pedestrian infrastructure. So, even though their distance to this amenity is minimal, that park does not provide the benefit it is supposed to offer to people who really need it. In order to tackle these challenges in a more systematic way, and to develop more customized metrics and design interventions, we need to grasp how people behave and experience their city or neighborhood. A design approach to urban health and well-being, drawing on location intelligence, adds this novel perspective to the analysis of the built environment. It has the ability to zoom in and out from citywide to human scale.